Hi, everyone. Is everyone still awake? Everyone got a good pizza in their stomach? All good? Okay, great. So I'm really excited to be back in my hometown. Reunited with my desi siutai kosong, my desi siutai, my chai tau kuei, and speaking at the Mozilla Developer Roadshow. I'm the last speaker, so I'm closing it out. So get as much pizza as you can get, even though I think they all run out. So I'm here to talk about designing for user-centered privacy. I have been taught that it's easier to first understand human behavior and design something that's in line with their mental models so that it's easier for users to adopt things. Trying to teach a new user to actually learn a new gesture, a new workflow, and you know, everyone tells you that you need to build things that's intuitive, that's easy for people. And then you try to convince users to change their viewpoint and change their fundamental human behavior. Honestly, it's a near impossible task. I've been grappling with this wicked problem, and I'm going to try a different tactic today. So hello, my name is Venetia Tay. I'm the head of audience insights at Mozilla. I'm based in San Francisco. I'm a mixed methods researcher and a strategist, and my background is in business strategy and user research. My role at Mozilla requires me to understand our target audience and to actually translate that insights for teams to help them drive decisions from people within the marketing team all the way to developing products. I also sometimes work with the emerging technologies team as well, which is why I know some of them, not everyone. And all this is in service of Mozilla's mission, which is to keep the web open and accessible to all. So the wicked problem that I've been tackling for the last 3 years has been, how do I get everyday people to care about their safety online? And how do I get them to care about their own privacy without using fear tactics? Because that's actually really easy to scare the shit out of people. We're not in the business of doing that. So today, instead of talking to users and everyday people, I want to talk to all of you. You are makers of systems, designer of products, designer of interfaces. You are architects of algorithms. I want you all to be thinking about designing for user-centered privacy. So the buzzword in the industry is user-centered design, customer-centricity. If you believe in creating a customer-centered experience, you have a responsibility of keeping your users' data safe. And why does data matter? Well, data is the new most invaluable resource out there right now. Even our Singapore government thinks that as well. There is a market for user data. A market research firm, Optimus, estimated that it will reach about 250 million by 2020. If you think about that, that's actually a rounding error for most of the big tech firms out there. That's how much Google probably generates revenue in like 16 hours. So it's not much. But if you think that data is the new currency, how are you and how are your companies actually managing it right now? So let's touch a little bit on the state of privacy. Where do we stand right now? I do a lot of global research. I talk to users from all over the world. These are some of the common things that they say, especially for people who are very unfamiliar with the privacy space. I'm not a target. I'm so insignificant. I'm so small. Why would anyone care about me? I'm not a celebrity. No one's interested in what I do. You know what? I've got nothing to hide. So even if everything I had leaked out, I really have nothing to hide at all. And perhaps on the other end, the people who are aware that companies are collecting their data, the haphazard use of data, and the overall need to protect themselves. This is what I've heard the excuses that they say. You know, it's so much work. It's so convenient to have everything connected, all my data connected. You know, privacy, just so much work. Like, why should I even bother doing that? In fact, our Singapore government does actually hint at that as well. You know, if I worry about every little thing, I won't be able to live my life. Like, I've got so many other things to worry about, the world, climate change, you know, raising taxes. Like, why would I care something about privacy? Like, that's nothing to me. And the other thing that people say is, you know what? This is the way it works right now. We're already fucked. What else can we do about it? Companies take all the data all the time. I can't say no because I need to use their stuff. And in Asia, you know, in a very family-centered society, that can make individual privacy very, very difficult. We have a kampung mentality. It makes personal privacy very challenging. Like most people, if you're not married, you're probably still living with your parents right now. I mean, that's the honest truth about Singapore. And for example, the relationships between families and friends are very close in Indonesia, which is some of our research there. It's normal for people to share mobile phones between each other for a short period of time. So again, think about privacy when you think everything's private on your phone. If you just share it with your best friend, your family, your mom, your dad, your sister, your brother. I remember that when I was growing up in Singapore, we used to fill out lucky draw forms that actually has, we put down our address, our phone number, our IC number. We drop it into like a transparent box outside NTUC, hoping to win maybe that cookery set, hoping to get a discount in something. We really give out all our information just for the promise of a discount or even the promise of a prize. You know, in Singapore, we know and we heard that, you know, just the chance of winning a lucky draw or discount is enough reason for many people to give up their data, give up all their personal information. So now that we're in Singapore, so specifically Singapore, you know, the government has outlined a smart nation policy about 5 years ago. You know, this includes nationwide digitization from ERP all the way to national electronic health records. The government wants to encourage the responsible sharing of personal data in order to generate value for our economy. You know, the government also talks about pulling all our personal data together so that multiple government agencies can provide a more hassle-free, seamless online transaction experience for anyone. If all the agencies all shared their data together, easy for you, what? Don't need to kind of fill multiple forms up. In fact, our IMDA Chief Executive Officer, Tan Kiat Hao, had even detailed his vision about establishing the world's first global data exchange to then be able for people to sell their data in a very regulated space. So, you know, and in the recent years, and actually the last 2 years, you've seen a number of new laws and regulations that the Singapore government has come up with. I believe the new personal data regulation law, the one that you see in the graphic on the left, you know, this will make the days where I fill out lucky draw forms and I put my NRIC number and drop it into a box, like that no longer exists anymore. This law came into effect, I believe, September 2019 this year. The government started a campaign to educate users about safeguarding your NRIC number. So you don't give your IC number away to anyone. You still keep it very close to you. The other interesting regulation that we have is also what, for shorthand, is the anti-fake news bill that actually bars dissemination online, which deems to be against public interest. You could be fined up to $1 million or 10 years in jail for spreading misinformation, even in your private networks. So like in WhatsApp or Signal, whatever you've been using. The key question is, if you ask yourself, how exactly would the government actually access all these private discussions on encrypted apps to police them? So you got to kind of think about that. But given that we're in Singapore, they'll find a way. And, you know, we all know that Singapore is actually big on surveillance. I'm sure you all know there are multiple cameras everywhere. There are probably multiple cameras here right now. But I bet you didn't know that the Singapore is actually the third most surveilled city outside of China. There's about 15.25 cameras for every 1,000 people in Singapore. But I'm not here to kind of make a statement of where Singapore should be on the state of privacy. Just want to kind of highlight that to you. So another question I get from people a lot, especially in Singapore, especially in Asia, why does privacy matter? In the case of surveillance, you know, it means that we are a safer place because we keep tabs on terrorism. I know that I grew up in a period of time where we were scared about the terrorist attacks, and having people being surveilled kind of kept us safe. But I also could paint you a very dystopian future that could come out straight off a Black Mirror episode, which I'm sure you guys get here as well. And, you know, the totalitarian governments could actually use personal identifiable information to harm vulnerable communities and to keep tabs on the population. Photo bubbles impact ideas and concepts that people actually are exposed to, making people very, very narrow-minded, very insular. I mean, look at the United States. That's a pretty obvious example of how photo bubbles can actually work. And especially potentially very, very close to our, you know, family-centered society, doxing. In some interviews that I've done, people, I heard about people losing their jobs, being threatened in real life, because they were outed before they were ready to be outed. So these are very real problems that could happen. Some of these concepts may seem foreign to us. And another way to look at it is that, you know, this lack of privacy just means that I get more targeted ads. I search online, I was looking at a pair of shoes, and then for the next like 2-3 weeks, that same pair of shoes follows me around the internet. I see it everywhere. Even sometimes after I bought it as well. It's irritating, but you know, it's not dire. I won't die because of a pair of shoes following me around the internet. So let me paint a picture that I think is very, very relevant to the Singapore audience right now. The first one, in our work in India, almost every participant we interviewed that had a VPN on their phone. They use VPN to actually block, you know, access websites blocked by the government, like Korean dramas. So they use the VPN to watch their Korean dramas. And they said that another reason why they use the VPN is to escape music suggestion from Bollywood-only music. If you're in India, you don't have a VPN, all you get in your streaming services are Bollywood music. And they felt that our users in India felt that it's their freedom to actually receive any content that they want, and they want to be able to explore beyond that. Another thing that I think will really hit the hearts of our Singaporeans is that air tickets, air flights. Have you noticed sometimes if you don't use incognito mode or you don't use Firefox, the more you check your prices for your airline tickets, the more it kind of increases over time, the higher it seems to get. So there's also research papers out there that says that, you know, if you're using a Mac, you could potentially see higher ticket prices than if you're using a Windows. The assumption is that because you have a Mac, you have more money. So if you have more money, you can pay for higher prices. Another story that will strike fear in people's hearts is insurance premiums might go up. So, you know, for example, if you were Googling, what does this mall actually mean? If your insurance company actually had access to that, they could think that mall could be cancerous. I'm going to start raising that person's insurance premiums. And they might charge you higher premiums as a result of that, just for something that you search. So anything weird that you might have searched, they could use it against you. And lastly, I know I see out here mostly men, so you may not really engage with this example, but period trackers that actually track women's menstrual apps. You know, women actually often track when it happens, what they were doing, how they were feeling at that point in time. You know, this is very sensitive health information data. They could be leaked, can even be sold to your employer. So can you imagine if you're trying to get pregnant, your company should actually fire you in advance because they don't want to pay for your maternity leave. And these are really real problems. All the examples I listed out here are things that actually do happen around the world and not only in Singapore. This is what happens. So what could you do? You know, I did mention at the start of my talk that I'm here to have you guys come on board. At Mozilla, we recommend a lean data policy. What does that mean? We all know that data is the new currency. Most people know that companies are collecting their data. Most people don't know when, they don't know what, they don't know why, and they don't know what it's used for. So the truth is some data collection is necessary to make a smooth, seamless experience for your user. But make sure that every piece of data that you collect provides direct user benefit. As you mentioned, data is a new currency. So as a developer, I want you to think about when, what, why, and what could it be used for. Think about it. Like, can your work still function if a user refrains from providing you with that one piece of information? If you can, you don't need it. You know, and if you are going to collect data, you know, we encourage you to collect data in the open, operate in good faith, and be open by default. At Mozilla, you know, we talk about no surprises. You have, we be transparent, disclose the benefits to the user. We talk about user control. So the user is in control of their data and their online experience. We talk about limited data collection. Only collect what you need, de-identify whenever you can, and after you're done with it, delete everything that you have. And we live this policy within Mozilla. So you can actually go to our wiki and check out our Firefox data collection policy. It's something we really believe in as well. So quick quiz. This is a popular Singapore website. I've kind of shaded out the name of the website just not to put them on a bad light, on the tough spot. So can anyone tell me how this experience could be improved? It's hard to see it. Oh, should make it bigger. So anyway, so I'll give you. So in providing convenience for the customer, they allow the customer to either log on by Google or log in with Facebook. You know, and because of that, you actually end up asking more data than you really need because you're actually giving data to the third party like Google and Facebook as well. In order to improve the experience, they should actually have an option for you to check out as a guest, and you don't have to then collect, kind of link all your shopping on this website to the back end of another third party website. So that's one thing they could do to improve, apart from just the UX. So key takeaways. So you think about framework for privacy standards in design, and all of you here are designers, even though you may not have the word design in your title, developers are designers too. So number one, adopt a lean data policy. You know, map out what you need and why you need it. Number two, communicate the effects and impacts. You know, demonstrate the benefits and the risks, both internally to your internal stakeholders as well as the consumers. Build a trusted relationship. Ask for active consent. Provide straightforward privacy settings and easy opt-outs. Don't hide the opt-out section somewhere in the middle or at the bottom. Make sure it's obvious for the users and give the users control. And lastly, respect the individual. When possible, share out and report what you use and, you know, why you used it. So before you request for your user's data, ask yourself these four things. Number one, would you ask for that piece of data if the person was sitting next to you in real life? Chances are, I would say about 50% of people will actually scale back on that. Number two, have I actively informed the user about what I'm collecting and why I'm collecting it? Number three, can I map out what I'm using the data for and why I'm collecting the piece of data? And lastly, this is the one that kind of trumps all, the last question. Is it creepy? If you feel it's creepy, don't do it. So in short, you have the responsibility to keep your data users safe. So even if you don't want, if you yourself aren't interested in data privacy for your own personal benefit and your own personal individual benefit, think about your users and help keep them safe. Thank you.